brought to you by Prescient Investment Management. Informed by science, guided by insight. Prescient Investment Management is an authorized FSP.
Welcome to the Honest Money Show. We're talking today about how the world's wealthy people invest their money. And it's a solo show today because I'm answering some of the questions that you've been sending to our WhatsApp line or our social media posts. And so unfortunately, you're just going to have to listen to me today. And I think maybe the first thing to talk about when we look at how the world's wealthy invest is that there are probably two categories of people that I want to talk about. So the first is the really ultra wealthy. So these are people that would count their wealth in, let's say, hundreds of millions of dollars or billions of dollars, and you know they're looking at assets that if all goes well would last hundreds of years, not tens of years, not from one generation to the next. And then the next category of wealthy people would be people that I would say are sitting on assets of about $10 million or more. And in South African terms, just to keep it really simple, just times it by 20, and you're looking at about that's kind of 200 million rand worth of assets. Why it's interesting to look at them and understand how they invest is we can't replicate exactly what they do, and we can't copy them exactly. And important to know that all of us are different. So we can't exactly just copy every other person we know to try and do what they do. It won't suit our lifestyle. It won't suit our age. It won't suit our family requirements, etc. But we can learn a lot of lessons from how wealthy people invest and how people who are financially successful invest. And for me, that's what they represent. It's people that have achieved a measure of financial success, and understanding how they do things with money can give us some pointers about how we do things with our own money. So I think the first thing is time horizon is probably the key point here. If you look at a wealthy family, the $10 million and more family, their time horizons are not kind of looking 1 or 3 years ahead. They're very often looking 10, 20, up to 50 years ahead with their investment decisions. And the reason for that is their children, who might be young, they know they've got money to leave at least to their children, and if things go well, to their children's children. So, if you've got a 10-year-old child, then and you're planning for your 10-year-old's children to be born still, you look very differently at how you make investment decisions. And I think that's a real key and a real secret weapon that they have that a lot of other people just don't give themselves. It's a very simple thing to do, in terms of looking at your investments and saying, if I own something today that's gone down like 2 or 3%, or maybe even 10 or 20%, is it still a good long-term investment? Is it still something I would hold if my time horizon was 20 years and I was only allowed to make one or two decisions every decade? And if the decision is yes, if it is a good investment and you would hold it for a long period of time, then it changes your whole outlook as to what's going on over a 1 or 2 or 3 year period. And in reality, we shouldn't really care too much about what happens to our investments over short periods of time, like 1 or 2 or 3 years. Forget about what happens over 1 or 2 or 3 months. And I think a lot of the time when I talk to investors and kind of listen to the kind of angst that they've got, the anxiety that they've got about their investments, it's really about short-term moves. And it's about, they invested their money and suddenly it's going down. And I ask them, well, how long have you been an investor? No, I've been an investor for 2 years and all I've seen are losses. Well, unfortunately, that's just bad luck in terms of timing. Doesn't make you a bad investor, and it doesn't mean that the investments that you own are bad. If the whole market's gone down for the 2 years you've been an investor, that's just tough luck. That doesn't mean you jump out and change your whole strategy or give up on the investment universe. If anything, what it tells you is maybe you should keep trying to accumulate assets a bit faster. Keep buying, because maybe these assets that you own are on sale now, and what you're doing is buying assets that will be rewarding to you over the next 10, 20, 30 years. And I think that's maybe the one really big key point that the world's wealthy, that the big focus area that they have. They just don't worry about what's going on over a very short period of time. It's not life-changing to them if their investments go down. And when you see news reports about, you know, the ultra wealthy have lost, you know, like $1 billion. You know, Elon Musk has lost $5 billion. I can promise you Elon Musk doesn't care about losing $5 billion when he's worth $100 billion. And the reason is he is so focused on long-term work and building his assets that he's got and building the businesses that he owns that what happens over a 1 or 2 year period is only interesting to the journalists. It's not interesting to the actual people that are building the wealth. And maybe that's the second comment, is they don't focus on what the media is telling them to focus on. They don't get excited when their friends on financial Twitter are telling them, you know, like, this is what's going on, or the people that they follow are suddenly panicking, because they've got just totally different time horizons. And that's a real key for us. So then the second thing is that they have a quite a rigid focus on how they break up the investment assets that they own. In other words, they don't take all their money and put it all in cash or all in property or all in shares or all in cryptos or all in derivatives or structured products or hedge funds. They're quite rigid in terms of splitting that out and making sure that their investments are spread across a range of types of assets with very different time horizons per asset. So, for example, when they own shares, they would say to themselves, I'm going to buy shares, and those are shares that I should be holding for at least a decade, if not 2 or 3. Whereas when they've got cash, they're looking to get a good interest rate, but they're not looking for kind of, you know, a 30-year horizon for their cash. The cash is there for a specific purpose, whether it's for an expense that's coming up in 1 or 2 or 3 years, or it's their emergency fund, or it's the shock absorber in the portfolio. It's not there to give them maximum capital growth, and they're certainly not looking for it to be the big growth generator for anything. It's there to fulfill a totally different role. And then when you look at their property holdings, you know, a lot of the world's very wealthy will own, you know, physical property, but it's a lifestyle asset. And I think it's an important point to know there. This is not about, you know, building massive wealth through property. It's about diversifying away from their main growth assets, diversifying away from their risky assets, and buying physical assets that hopefully will protect their capital against inflation, but equally are places where they will go and spend time. You know, so you'll see, you know, some of the world's wealthy buying, you know, the $50 million or $100 million properties on the coast somewhere that's in high demand, and they might end up with a few of those around the world. And the idea there is that, you know, yes, it's a more form of diversification. Yes, it's a nice lifestyle, so they don't have to go and stay in hotels, but equally that it protects them from other different kinds of risks that the rest of their money might be exposed to. And that's an important point. It's about diversification there. But they will have a very long time horizon on those property assets. And then they might own private businesses as well. And you know, if it's not the family business, or it's not the business that they started themselves, they might buy private companies either through private equity or through investment trusts that own private businesses. And I think that's an increasing kind of dynamic in the world where they're very large, very well-run businesses that are not going to the stock exchange anywhere in the world anymore. They're staying private, raising money privately when they need it. And I think the world's wealthy have a specific advantage there, because they will get approached for investments. And secondly, they can afford to take a 10 or 20 year view on a private investment. They're not trying to buy something that they need to trade next week or next month or next year. And when you've got a very successful private business and you're looking for shareholders, what you want are long-term shareholders. So I think that's something that they own that maybe isn't always accessible to everybody else. Having said that, there are good investment trusts that are listed, especially in the UK, that specialize in buying stakes in private companies. And you know, that's important to look at if you want to access that kind of side of the market. On the other end of the spectrum, once they've got their cash holdings sorted out, the world's wealthy might buy some physical assets like gold, you know, silver or physical commodities. And it's another form of portfolio insurance for them. They're not buying their gold holdings so that they expect to double or treble that money over long periods of time. All they're doing is they're buying an asset which is physical, which can be used in the event that, you know, the financial systems really go south, or, you know, something really horrible goes wrong around the world. They've got these physical assets that can be used to trade or to kind of restart their wealth in a completely different way. So for me, one powerful learning there is that, you know, when you're still trying to build up your capital and you don't have sufficient capital, you don't need too much portfolio insurance with, for example, with too much cash or too much in physical commodities. Rather buy growth assets that are well diversified in the hope that that's actually how you kind of build your wealth. When you get to the point where you've got some excess wealth, then you start to allocate some of that to portfolio insurance. And that means increasing cash holdings or buying physical commodities. But those who are looking at the world's wealthy and saying, well, they own some gold, I should own some gold, you just need to understand why they own the gold. And it's not for growth. It's purely for protection. And if you're not in a position where you need to protect capital, but rather need to grow it, then I would suggest that's not your first priority. And then you might find the world's wealthy owning some kind of more exotic investments like funds of hedge funds or private equity funds, just as a general rule. Or, you know, they might take a punt on some new fashion thing, you know, whether it's cryptos last year or whatever it will be next year. But they'll do that with a small amount of money. They won't do it with a large chunk. And you know, if that small amount of money, you know, it goes well and it doubles or trebles in their lives, it will add to their growth, but it's not something that will change their lives. And equally, if that small amount of money loses everything, which is always possible, that's not going to change their lifestyle either. And I think the point there is when you've got big size of assets, you can negotiate fees much more readily than the rest of us who might only be able to invest small amounts. And we can't go and, you know, tell fund managers to give us special discounts on our assets. So I think there, those kind of exotic products, you know, whether it's hedge funds or private equity funds, as a principle, I tend to avoid them because they're expensive. You know, the people making the most money there are the actual launchers of those products, the fund managers of those products, and they make a lot of money. There's a reason why some of the hedge fund managers in America are some of the world's wealthiest people. It's because they've made all the money, not their clients. And that really bothers me. So, you know, fees are a critical point here. And if you can't negotiate, a fee down on an exotic product, why buy it? And then maybe also just staying on that for a second, hedge funds, especially those where you don't really know what's going on inside, or some newfangled product where, you know, it's so complicated and so mathematical and someone tells you, you know, you're never going to understand. That to me is a great reason to not buy that product. You know, when you can't understand what you own and you can't simply track it, you know, in other words, you can't go online and look at the financial website that will tell you how this investment is performing and what the prices are, etc. When there's some sort of magic black box, you know, don't talk to me kind of approach from the product provider, that for me is a real red flag. I don't need to invest my money with companies that are not going to tell me what's going on with my investments. So I'll avoid those. And sure, not all of those companies are dodgy and not all of them are going to steal my money, but a proportion of them will, and a proportion of them will be the next Bernie Madoff or next big Ponzi scheme. And why take the risk? You know, I think, you know, missing out on one or two investments that do incredibly well, while at the same time missing out on hundreds of investments that are fraudulent or just super expensive, I'm very comfortable to avoid those. So I think just be careful there that the way that you invest and the fees that you pay. And then lastly, with the world's wealthy, they will spread their assets far and wide. They will have a lot of money in their home country, wherever they plan to spend and their time and their money. But they're equally comfortable to allocate lots of money around the world. And sometimes they do it very simply, you know, whether it's in index investments or in balanced unit trusts. And sometimes they'll buy lots of different kinds of investments across the world. But they're not afraid to diversify. And they simply look at their investments in a different way than most. And I think the key point there is when you're sitting on, you know, 100 million or 200 million rand, your job is not to make the 200 million into a billion. Your job is to protect that 200 million from a permanent loss of capital. In other words, you don't want to invest the money and, you know, you've got 200 million and suddenly you wake up one day and it's only worth 10 million. You know, that's a catastrophic risk. That's like playing Russian roulette with your money. And that's a really bad idea. So what the world's wealthy do is they look at their money and they say, overall, with the entire pot, my job is to protect it and preserve it, and especially against the eroding effects of inflation. You know, when the whole point about inflation is it gradually destroys the buying power of your money, and that's really bad. So what you want to do is you want to protect the buying power of your money. You want to grow it at least at the rate of inflation. That's when you're looking at the entire amount. That doesn't mean that all of your money needs to be really conservatively invested. It just means that some portions need to be very cautious. Some portions can be quite high risk. But when you mix it all together and you look at the whole pot needs to make sure that you're not going to be in a position where you wake up one day with very little money left. You know, and I think that that's a big attitude adjustment that a lot of investors need to make as their capital grows. Is it's not all about growth. You know, at some point you start to make sure that you don't lose the money forever. And that's maybe the one thing that I would love to give as a tip to investors is, you know, this is a long-term game. You know, this should be kind of running the comrades ultra marathon. You're not out there to kind of get be the fastest person to run 10Ks. You need to get the whole 90Ks done, you know. And sometimes just staying invested, just staying on the road, just going day after day, week after week, month after month, year after year is the secret. That is the key to actually how you become very successful as an investor and potentially one day, you know, incredibly wealthy. It's about sticking to a plan and staying in it and not chopping and changing, not getting distracted by all the new kind of bright, shiny objects that get thrown at you by especially social media nowadays. And then I know this is a podcast, which is kind of a newish form of media. And I know we run Twitter accounts and YouTube channels and everything. But the one thing I'd say to you as well is don't get distracted by FOMO and don't get distracted by people that kind of, you know, take photos of themselves in front of fancy cars. You know, I mean, I love it when I see people kind of walking up to a parked Ferrari and they go and stand there as if it's their car and they, you know, they're taking selfies. And I never go and talk to those people, but I bet you they're putting those on social media saying, you know, living my best life, driving my favorite car. It's all nonsense. And I think, you know, people who spend their time on social media, especially doing the selfies, bragging about how rich they are, or how successful they are, they're not the ones making the real money. You know, the ones that are making real money are busy either spending their time building more money or they're spending their time at leisure and not kind of showing it to the rest of the world. And I think, you know, be careful of the influencers. The influencers usually kind of clueless, can't do much themselves, can't really make a business out of whatever it is that they want to do, certainly can't get a career, and they've got nothing else left. So they go into social media. Bothers me a lot, as you can hear, and I think it often leads to really bad outcomes for investors who naively believe what they're seeing on social media. So maybe that's my last tip is avoid the social media, avoid fear of missing out. You know, FOMO is such a dangerous thing when you make investment decisions. I hope that helps, and I hope you have a very successful investment career.
Brought to you by Prescient Investment Management. Informed by science, guided by insight. Prescient Investment Management is an authorized FSP.